start the questions.
The first question today is from Sai Durga, IA participant ID number 75, who's asking, beloved Swamiji, what is sannyas as per Vedic tradition? What are the ethics followed by a sannyasi and the qualities he should display? Also, could you please give us some insights on the Manusmriti and who Manu was? Thank you so much, Swami. Sai Durga.
Sai Durga, it's a beautiful question. What is sannyas as per Vedic tradition? Enlightenment, using a body and breathing life into the science of enlightenment is sannyas. Understand? Enlightenment, breathing, and assuming a body and breathing life into enlightenment science is sannyas. What are the ethics followed by a sannyasi? Please understand, all the ethics, all the morals, all the codes of conduct, everything is dependent on the country, state, village, community, time they live in. Only one great ethics by them, they radiate intense bliss, energy, and completely centered on the higher self. You are asking what are the ethics followed by a sannyasi and the qualities he should display. No. The moment you fix some qualities that he should display, there is every possibility you will create hypocritical sannyasis. My whole struggle between me and my sannyasis is trying to create, evolve them to an enlightenment, radiating enlightenment, without giving them pseudo-ethics. If I would have created a pseudo-ethics, by now I would have had lakhs of sannyasis, because it is very easy to follow any pseudo-ethics. If I say, be always smiling, be always compassionate, just be non-possessive, if I just give some 10 rules and this is enough, you display these qualities, I will have lakhs here sitting around me. Pseudo-ethics gives more comfort to people. But the real sannyas is all about consciousness. Growing, establishing yourself with the pure enlightenment. Pseudo-ethics is like marriage, sannyas is eternal romance. With pseudo-ethics you come to terms and settle down. You settle. I tell you, pseudo-ethics is not what I expect from my sannyasis. Be honest to your core. Be true to your capacity. Be true to your possibility. Also, could you please give us some insights on Manusmriti and who Manu was? Manu was the first human being, enlightened human being, started developing a concept of civilization. the first human being who started thinking and developing the concept of human civilization. His collective accepted understandings are only called Manusmriti. Please understand. Collectively accepted understandings is Manusmriti. It was not written autocratically by him. It was more like a democratic understandings which was collected by him. It's like he was the president of the human civilization, first human civilization. Daksha Prajapati was prime minister. That is the way the human civilization started. Manu was doing more of a spiritual work and Daksha Prajapati was doing more of a execution. Daksha Prajapati is son-in-law of Manu. Manu's daughter Prasuti. The meaning of the Prasuti means execution power. Executive power. I don't know whether it was really a woman named as Prasuti or it is just the power given by Manu to Daksha Prajapati. But Daksha Prajapati was considered as the son-in-law of Manu. So in the Thiruvalaiyadar Puranam, the history of Madurai, it is very clearly written, Meenakshi's adopted father and grandfather, Meenakshi herself and the Meenakshi's son Ukrabandian, all four of them used Manusmriti as a law of Madura. Madurai was ruled accordance to Manusmriti. There is a clear record. So, again, Madurai will be ruled as per Manusmriti. Next question.
The next question is from Zuzana, IA number 16, who is saying, Dearest Swamiji, please specify and clarify these three terms, Kundalini awakening, third eye opening, enlightenment, and how exactly is each of these phases manifested in the body? Thank you.
Susanna, it's a very funny question. She's asking, please specify and clarify these three terms, Kundalini awakening, third eye opening, enlightenment. I can say Kundalini awakening is like a first step. Your body starts responding to the highest auspicious presence. Third eye opening is like your body, your biomemory is connected to that highest auspicious presence. Enlightenment is like becoming one with that auspicious presence. It's like you getting up and moving the screen is Kundalini awakening. Seeing what is there on the other side is third eye opening. Becoming one with the other side is enlightenment. So in Kundalini awakening, biomemory feels the heat of the consciousness. In third eye opening, biomemory feels connected to the conscious presence. In enlightenment, biomemory becomes one with the conscious presence. Being in his presence awakens Kundalini. Working with his presence awakens third eye opening. Becoming his presence is enlightenment. If I had to put it more precisely, in this inner awakening, I am working more on the third eye opening than Kundalini awakening. That is why less shaking, more transformation. The body movement outside is lot less, but inside is too much. How many of you feel that outside it is not shaking much, but inside it is unbearable going through in the spine? So be very clear, it's third eye opening. So this whole inner awakening, I am working more on the third eye opening. I am not encouraging the body movement much, but programming less movement, more transformation. Less shaking, more shocking. Next question.
The next question is from Jens Glende, IA number 52, who's asking, Dear Swamiji, is there a connection between the Kundalini and the Mer Kaba, the light body that the ancient Egyptians worked with?
Jens Glende, there is a strong connection between third eye and the Mer Kaba. What Egyptians call as a light body is related to third eye more than Kundalini awakening. Egyptians have worked very strongly with the third eye, and that is why their pyramids, you can never build those pyramids with the ordinary eye such precise. It was their third eye capacity which was responsible for their precision. Do you know the measurement, the geometrical precision the pyramid carries is more precise than the CS Tower or the Petronas Tower of Malaysia? Go to the Google, go to the internet Google, you will see the precision CS Tower is able to maintain with all the equipments. And the New York, there's one more tower, Empire State Building, yes. The precision, all the modern buildings are able to maintain, the Empire State Building, and the precision, the Petronas Tower in Malaysia, they have compared with some four modern buildings. The pyramids' precision, their measurements are more accurate than the precision of CS Tower or Empire State Building or Malaysia Petronas Tower, Twin Towers. I'll put this information with records into our website, you can see, because I can't go through, as I am not an architect, I don't understand much of these details. I only understood the concept. They are comparing how they are more precise, how they are more precise than the precision of CS Towers and all that. So it is not possible by ordinary two eyes. It's only because of their capability of third eye. I have seen in Indian villages, the village carpenters, for them to make that 90 degree angle, they will come to the temple stone pillars and make the mold, take the mold and go. I've seen still in Thiruvannamalai, because that's the most precise, the 90 degree angle, the temple pillars, which is carved, I don't know how many thousands of years before, without any instruments, machineries. So Egyptians have worked so much on the third eye. Only thing they missed is the last part of enlightenment. Somehow, unfortunately, the people who funded the research have influenced the research in the last part. See, in India, kings have funded the research but never able to influence the Brahmins. Brahmins are very clear. You may fund the research, but you can't influence. You are separate and the research results are separate. Bow down to the Brahmins and sannyasis for keeping their research and development unadulterated by the whims and fancies of the funders of researches. See, in the modern day, any research will be funded by company or anybody only if the results are going to be in their vested interests. If it is only going to favor their vested interests, support their packet, but the Brahmins and sannyasis have kept the purity of the research and development. They saw to it. They took the responsibility of not being influenced by the kings who fund the research. But in Egypt that did not happen. The researchers were influenced by kings. Finally, the place of the Almighty, ultimate, the unknown God was taken over by the king itself. That's the only place where they missed. In India, we did not allow that. We did not allow the king worship. Meenakshi was not worshipped because she is a queen. She was a queen, no. She was worshipped because she was God. If it was the reason, if that being a queen was the reason for her worship, then her mother would have been worshipped. Her daughter-in-law would have been worshipped. No. Her father would have been worshipped. No. We don't even know where their samadhi is. Meenakshi was worshipped because she was incarnation, God, not because she was king or queen.
Paramahamsan Nityananda, a rare living incarnation, is named among the world's 100 most spiritually influential personalities today. Paramahamsa Nityananda has been placed alongside Dalai Lama, Nelson Mandela, Oprah Winfrey, Paulo Coelho and others by Mind, Body, Spirit, the world's top esoteric magazine from Watkins, London's oldest and largest bookstore. A yogi by birth, he has been expressing his power of enlightenment since birth. He has authored more than 500 books in Tamil and English. Translations of these books are available in 26 languages in Telugu, Kannada, Malayalam, Hindi, Sanskrit, Gujarati, Oriya, Bengali, Marathi, French, Malay, Polish, Portuguese, Italian, German, Danish, Spanish, Russian, and Chinese. He is also an exemplary speaker with over 10,000 hours of profound life solutions through his discourses. Social services such as Annadan, free medical care, free educational services with ashrams, schools, temples, hospitals established in more than 140 places around the world, offering exceptional services. A powerful spiritual healer who has healed millions of people of diseases from migraine to cancer, a Kriya Yogi who has formulated Kriyas for physical health and mental well-being benefiting thousands, a living master who offers practical solutions for our everyday problems. He is the founder and spiritual head of Nityananda Dhyanapitam, a spiritual powerhouse who has revived the sacred Vedic tradition by establishing Vedic temples in places like Los Angeles, San Jose, Seattle, Toronto, Ohio, Oklahoma, Phoenix, St. Louis, Malaysia, Brazil, Paris, Guadeloupe, Dallas, New York, New Jersey, Atlanta, Calgary, Vancouver, Singapore, and places in India like Bengaluru, Hyderabad, Tiruvannamalai. A spiritual guru for 10 million followers, an incarnation who transmits the highest spiritual energy through initiation, a contemporary yogi who has revived the Vedic science of yoga worldwide through thousands of yoga centers, an adept in Ashtamahasiddhis, mystical yogic powers, who has effortlessly awakened the kundalini of thousands and graced them with spiritual powers, a dynamic young guru who is an inspiration for thousands of youngsters, India's most watched spiritual guru online, a beacon of spiritual light who has triumphed over the forces of religious terrorism and political persecution. Paramahamsa Nityananda is an eternal Kalpataru, blessing the world with the boons of material abundance and spiritual enlightenment.
वंदे पाप विनाशकम् नित्यानंदाय स्वागतम् नित्यमुक्तम् निर्विकल्पम् ध्यानलोक प्रदीपकम् वंदे शांतमयम् बंधम् नित्यानंदाय स्वागतम् आनंद गंध संचारम् सर्वोपाधि विनिर्मुक्तम् वंदे ज्ञानालयम् नाथम् नित्यानंदाय स्वागतम्
Let you all achieve, experience, live, express, radiate, share, and explode in eternal bliss. Nityananda.
Nityananda Dhyana Peetham, Nityananda Nagar, off Mysore Road, Bidadi, Bangalore, 562109. Contact 0974220311. www.nityananda.org. www.youtube.com/lifebliss foundation.